It was a film that, if you had the patience, it's a film that came from the heart. It came from meaning that it was something that was a personal project, really. And I'm speaking that way as the director, but primarily I did not write it. I mean, Paul Schrader wrote it. He lived those feelings. I lived those feelings. He was able to express them a certain way, and I just became enamored of it and fought to get it on the screen the way he wrote it, the way we envisioned it, in a way. Paul, myself, De Niro, everybody involved with the project. The script was given to me by Brian De Palma. He thought it was a wonderful script and thought it would be something that I should direct. But of course, at that point in time, I hadn't really directed any films of note. I directed an independent feature over a period of several years called Who's That Knocking at My Door, which wasn't very successful. And then a exploitation film for Roger Corman called Boxcar Bertha. And they really weren't the credentials to get a studio to back me, or had the producers of the film, which were Michael and Julia Phillips, who were very good, great producers and very supportive throughout the whole picture. But there really wasn't anything to bank on there to, I would walk around and tell her I want to do the picture, and she said, well, come back when you've done something more than Boxcar Bertha, and she was quite right. But then they saw the rough cut of Mean Streets, a rough cut of it, and they changed their minds. It was really a nice, very nice time for us, about 1972, 73, I think, because the subject matter at the time, even at that time, was kind of difficult subject matter for a studio. And with the right budget, and with the combination of me and De Niro coming off of Mean Streets, they thought they might have the possibility of making the picture. I remember talking to Dustin Hoffman about it first. He was about to do Lenny at that time. And I think then there was talk of other actors, but when I think De Niro was off on another picture or something, I think it was Godfather 2. So, but when it worked out that Bob was willing to do it, and the studio seeing Mean Streets, buying Mean Streets, actually Warner Brothers, and then having me do Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, which was a more commercial picture in a sense, and that was successful. So we had the possibility then of making the picture, but even then the budget was really constricted at that time. We just wanted to make the film. We felt very passionate about the script, and we even thought, Michael and Julia Phillips and myself, we thought of making the film in video, if need be, on video, and in black and white video. There was talk of doing it in a different city, but then it wouldn't be the same. The taxi systems in other cities in America are different to a certain extent. So we knew we had to stay in New York, and it was pretty expensive. And the script was so tight and so strong that it made it very clear in my mind as to how the picture should look. And really comes from Schrader's vision in the telling of the story. And ultimately, I realized that visually, we should pretty much see everything from Travis's point of view. Not that anybody else's thought process or frame of mind really enter into the film. And this would isolate him more and put you more on his side, so to speak. Not that we were looking for that, but meaning that it just seemed to me, no matter what the character is, that you're sort of, you're going along the journey with that character. You may like the character, you may not, but it's just so that you're interested in the character. We certainly felt, De Niro, myself, and sort of Chapman, we felt very strongly about the emotions that the story created in us, in a way that evoked from us, and it made us very passionate about making the film and making the best film we could make under the circumstances, and then, of course, defending it in the editing, too. That became a big issue. But it's interesting to note, I think, that it was a film that we didn't think was going to be seen by anybody. We just had to make it. We didn't think it was going to be successful financially, and it was. And we didn't think it was going to be recognized critically, and it was. We just had to make it. We were going on to make other pictures. At that time, I was thinking of doing, different genre-type-based films in the Hollywood studios. What was left of the studio system at the time was very little. And the process was all changing, and we were part of that change. Coppola, Bogdanovich, and Friedkin were already there. And then was Lucas, Spielberg, myself, Paul Schrader, John Milius, and a number of others. I may be forgetting a few, but we began to change things. It was in the doing of it. This film comes out of a very special time, but we thought we were also going to change the genres. And I think probably Lucas and Spielberg were the ones who were most successful at that, meaning they took the genres from the past and recreated them for the new. If we can say it was, in a way, to carry on a line through the cinema of the past or that cinema of the present that was important to us at the time. And so that if people are interested in the film and why a certain shot is a certain way, we'd say, well, it kind of relates to certain shots in Jean-Luc Godard's picture at that time. But they're way beyond me. I can't begin to think about what the Godard pictures are, what they're about, or, you know. I mean, I just reacted certain ways emotionally to the ones he made in the 60s and through the into the 70s. And so there was a certain detachment that was interesting to me in the way he shot certain scenes, yet they were very powerful and emotional. There's also a reference, not really a reference, but a very strong influence of Fassbender's work on me at that time in Taxi Driver. So two or three of his pictures. And there was a certain honesty about the shooting. Again, I can't quite tell you, I can't tell you what the films, I can't analyze the films, I can't tell you what they're about or whatever, but I had a certain emotional reaction to The Merchant of Four Seasons, for example, when I saw that. I've only seen it once or twice, but I'm not a film critic. I don't know exactly where Fassbender was going, but I admire his work a lot, and I admire his extraordinary blocking and work with actors. And so that film had a certain power and honesty to me, and that kind of the spirit of that picture permeates the attitude towards a lot of the scenes in Taxi Driver, the way I approach the scenes. But that means everything, shooting, directing the actors, everything. And it freed me in a way. There's also very powerful references and subtext to Francesco Rossi's films, Salvatore Giuliano and Hands Over the City, which we studied for. I wanted the look, let's say, of Salvatore Giuliano, and I wanted the look of that. That was in black and white, but I wanted the sense of that in color. And Michael Chapman and I studied that. We studied The Fire Within, Louis Malle's film, looked at that. But primarily Francesco Rossi and The Wrong Man again, Hitchcock, The Wrong Man, which I keep referencing a lot for other people to see in terms of its sense of camera movement, a sense of guilt and paranoia through camera movement. And even as recently as The Aviator, I screened it again for the actors and for cameramen. There were a lot of films. I can go back, A Bigger Splash, a film made by David Hockney in California by Jack Kazan, his name was. It was an interesting film. And also, that led to certain angles that I thought were interesting, which became very flat head-on angles of locations. For example, the one I could reference, when he drops somebody off at a hotel, it shot pretty much head-on, flat, and which relates directly to this shot that I described, which is Travis's car in front of the grocery store before he commits his first murder. So the linking of the sense of the camera being away from the action and just presenting it like a tableau, almost. This was very important to me. And something, for some reason, The Bigger Splash had a very strong relation to that. In my mind, it sparked that kind of shooting. And so a number of films that we kept dealing with, looking at, we'd have screenings prior to the shooting of the picture, Michael Chapman, myself. What made this film special was that the precision with which Schrader was able to create the character, the feelings, the thoughts, the psychological insight, this character of Travis Bickle. And I just identified with him. We identified with him, and that's all. We understood how he felt. And disaffected, disillusioned, maybe ostracized from mainstream society, maybe for me in my own personal life, being an outsider. He's an outsider, a loner, a loser to a certain extent. And there was something that touched a chord in me that I felt I could express that through the visual interpretation. Through the visual interpretation of the film, really, and utilizing the key instrument, really, and more than instrument, It's the voice, and that is the actor, Robert De Niro, and what he was able to bring to the picture. I think he understood it, too. We never really verbalized it. We can't verbalize it. I mean, I'm verbalizing it now to a certain extent because people have said things to me over the years, you know. when I said then what I put into the picture is different from what I really put into the film. I mean, that was just the spark of it. That was just the beginning. And then something else happens when you're working it out so that it's more intuitive. The hallucinatory idea is definitely a point of view. When a person crosses the line between fantasy and reality, reality into fantasy, the fantasy is as real as the reality. It's real. The dream's real. The paranoia is real. The people may not be doing anything against you, but you believe they are. And so that's probably what I was getting at in talking about hallucinatory. Well, drug-induced, he drinks a bit. He takes some pills to keep awake. He's young enough, in a sense, the body's strong. His body is strong. It does change your perception, particularly working at night, and particularly if you take pills to keep you awake, work at night. It creates a kind of strange subterranean, opens a subterranean, I mean, that I experienced, opens a strange world to you that images, shadows lurking. But I'm also an urban person. I see things that way. But if you keep pushing at night and work at night without drugs, that does something to a person who works at night, especially driving in the streets and not knowing who's going to get into your car. Because when that person gets in your car, that person controls your life for the next 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, tells you where to go. And it's very dangerous, and he's living on the edge, you know. So naturally, things begin to take on a different meaning to him, especially at 4:30 in the morning. If Taxi Driver comes out of any genre at all, it's kind of a noir in a way. That was intentional. The noir film from 1945 to 1955, ending with Kiss Me Deadly, that first series of noirs going mid-war from Double Indemnity to Kiss Me Deadly. That had a strong effect on me, those pictures, because I happened to see them in a theater when I was a kid. You just go to the movie theater, and there was a Western, and then there was this strange thing in black and white where everybody was kind of doomed from the beginning, walking around in trench coats, and it was pretty rough stuff for kids to see. And so there was a direct line there, too, to noir film, but also to the European cinema. There's no doubt, French, but French, Italian, British, to a certain extent. And so this film comes out of a time that was a great influence of foreign cinema on American filmmakers. But also primarily, I guess, thing to understand is that it was a labor of love and that we hadn't expected any success from it. I think personal filmmaking always considers the audience, because you are the audience. You really are. Who are you telling the story to? You're going to be telling your story to somebody who want to listen, we hope. Who want to watch, who want to experience, I should say. So personal filmmaking, and the best kind, I think, opens a line of communication with people in the audience that you don't expect from, in the case of Taxi Driver, it was from people in America to people in Mongolia. I was in China in 1984. Young man was asking me questions. He came from Mongolia. He was asking me questions repeatedly about Taxi Driver, ultimately ending in a question, what do you do about the loneliness? And so, I mean, this is a picture that I hadn't expected for people to identify with, but it touched a nerve, and that's what Schrader wrote in terms of the character, Travis Bickle, and the way De Niro acted it. I think there's a certain truth about there's a certain truth that Schrader hit upon in depicting the character of Travis. I still can't really verbalize it. I mean, the only way I can express it is this extraordinary reaction I had when I first read Notes from Underground, Fyodor Dostoevsky. And that, I felt, was something that I said, oh, I had many of those feelings. That's me. You know, a lot of people do that. And I was talking to the novelist Russell Banks. He said, me too. That's, everybody feels that way when they read that. So I don't know if everybody does, but it hit me. And I think Taxi Driver, when I read the script, hit me in a similar way, struck me in a similar way. That, and they use the words hit, strike, because it's a violent feeling. And it's an angry feeling, there's no doubt. But it depends on one, how one deals with it. And Travis just does it the wrong way. There's no doubt about it. But again, disaffected, ostracized, outsider, inability to have a relationship with people. I mean, a lot of this is just something that, you know, from my own life that I found in Travis. Well, the thing about it is that, of course, we found it very special, but we didn't say everybody feels this way. We thought we did. We thought we were like unique in this. I mean, we just felt, geez, we, you know, really feel bad and we're really upset. And this is how we feel about life and things. And it was really part of it was a coming of age process for all of us, Schrader, myself, De Niro. And maybe part of that, maybe that's a similar thing for younger people watching the film who are affected by it. Maybe it's part of a coming of age process. The thing is not to get stuck there. One can have those feelings and not cross the line. It's just being honest with yourself and truthful, that's all.